What is going on, everybody? Welcome back to the Gear Focus channel. I'm your host, Dan, and today we're going to be taking an in-depth look at the Canon EOS R. This is going to be a full tutorial video for this camera, so it's going to be a little bit of a long video. So go ahead and grab a coffee or a beer or whatever you like to drink so that we can get started. I'm going to put all of the timestamps down in the description below so that you can jump to any section that you might need to. But without further ado, let's go ahead and jump right into it. So we're going to start by talking about the form of the camera. So the first big thing on the EOS R is the new RF mount. This was the first camera from Canon to sport the new RF mount. Now for you EF lens users, don't worry, there are several different adapter options. The standard adapter starts at just $100, and there are different versions of that that have a control ring and also an internal ND filter. This camera also uses the Canon LPE6N battery, which is pretty standard across their DSLR cameras, like the 5D Mark IV and Mark III. So if we take a look at the top of the camera, we have our on-off switch here to the left. And then immediately next to that, we have our hot shoe mount. Then we have our LCD screen, our mode select and dial, our record button, our lock button, another programmable dial, which we will get into in a little bit, a multifunction button, and of course your shutter button. Now also on the top of the camera, there is a button with a light bulb next to it. This is a custom programmable button, and again, we'll get into that a little bit later. Now working our way to the left side of the camera, underneath of our weather sealing, we have our remote plug. We have our mic jack as well as our headphone jack and a USB-C port and a mini HDMI port. On the right side of this camera, we have our SD card slot. This camera does only have one SD card slot, which isn't exactly the greatest thing, but it's not a huge problem either. In order to remove that SD card, you can go ahead and just press down on the SD card and it'll spring right up. And then in order to put the card in, you just want to orient it just like the diagram shows on the back of that door and press it in until you hear it click in place. So let's go ahead and work our way to the back of the camera. On the top left, you have your menu button, which is pretty self-explanatory. When you press that, it brings the menu up. Underneath of that, we have our flip-out LCD screen, and this is articulating, so you can spin it any which way you want. I like to leave it either flat on the back, or I'll bring it out to the side so that I can use it and tilt it however I need to. Directly above our LCD screen, we have our electronic viewfinder, or EVF, and this also has a diopter on it to adjust the view in that EVF. Directly next to the EVF is the infamous touch bar. I don't use that bar, but I'll show you how to set that up later on in the video. On the right side of the camera by the grip, we have our AF on button, which turns our autofocus on or off. We have this asterisk button, which can be programmed to do a lot of different things, and we'll get into that a little bit later. Underneath of that, we have our grids button or our on-screen display. So working our way down a little bit further, we have our info button. One of the great things about this camera is it has a built-in user guide. So if you're scrolling through your camera, you can't quite figure out what a setting does and you see the info banner at the bottom, you can go ahead and press the info button and it'll bring up a description for what that setting does. Personally, I think that's a really great feature to have on a camera so you don't have to constantly be pulling out your user manual. Directly underneath of that info button, we have our D-pad or directional pad with the enter, cue, or set button in the middle of that. You can call it whatever you want. It does a bunch of different things, and we'll get into that more a little bit later as well. And then at the bottom of the camera, we have our playback button as well as our trash can. So now we've taken a look at all of the physical attributes for this camera. Let's go ahead, turn the camera on, and go into the menu system so that we can see exactly what this camera can do. So before we jump into the menu system, I just want to note that I'm going to be going over the video specifications first, and then I'll be going over the photo specs. But again, I'll put the timestamps down in the description below. So let's go ahead and press that menu button, and we'll jump to the first page on the camera setup menu. So now that we're in the menu, we have a bunch of different main tabs at the top, as well as sub tabs within those. So we're going to start with the camera all the way on the left and with the number one. Now, this is a touchscreen camera, so we can change all of the settings by using the touchscreen, or we can use that D-pad that I mentioned earlier. The first thing that we're going to be able to set is our movie recording quality. Now, something to note that there is a 1.75 times crop on the 4K modes for this camera. However, if you film in the 1080p modes, you will get full frame. Now we can record 4K up to 30 frames per second and 1080 up to 60 frames per second. We do have 120 frames per second option in 720p as well. So once we get into the movie recording size menu, you'll notice that there are two options for every frame rate. We have the All-I and we have the IPB. The All-I codec is a slightly less compressed codec than the IPB. I use the IPB setting as it keeps my file sizes down and the compression is really pretty good. But if you need a little bit more flexibility with your image in post, you can go ahead and just select the All-I option. Now, if we go back one more page, underneath of the movie recording size, you'll see a 24p with a disabled notification next to it. If we click on that, that is the playback for your video. So if you're filming in a higher frame rate and you hit that 24p, it'll play everything back in 24p, so everything will be slow-mo when you look at it if you filmed in 60 or 30 frames. And directly underneath that, we have our high frame rate enabling. This is where we access that 120 frames in 720p that I mentioned earlier. Directly underneath of our movie recording quality selection, we have our movie crop. I personally leave that disabled at all times because I like to have the full sensor image for my videos. Directly underneath of the crop is our sound recording menu. I leave that to manual as I do like to adjust my settings for my audio depending on what my source is, and I personally don't trust any internal attenuation. I like to leave everything set as manually as I can, but again, that's just personal preference, and that's not something that you're really into. You can go ahead and enable the automatic ducking. Directly underneath of our sound recording menu, we have our timecode menu. I don't use the internal timecode on the camera, but you can set those timecode options with that menu. So we'll go ahead and dive into that real quick. You have your count up in record, run, or free run. You have your start time setting. So you have the ability to set a manual input. You can reset it or set to the camera time. Your movie recording count, you can also set to record time or timecode. I'm going to leave that on record time, movie play count, record time, and time code as well. And then for your HDMI output, you can set your time code to on or off for your external monitors. Directly underneath of the time code is the digital image stabilization. There is no in-body image stabilization on the EOS R. However, the image stabilization that it does have is completely digital. Now, if you use this camera with a lens that has image stabilization, you are still going to get the image stabilization out of the lens. And I pretty much only use lenses with IS built into them, so I leave that disabled. But there are three different options for image stabilization. You have obviously on or off, or you have the enhanced. Personally, if I was going to be doing it, I would leave it on the default setting as the enhanced in the past for me has given me some artifacting in the image. All right, so moving over to the second page of the camera settings, we have our lens aberration correction. And in here you have the ability to disable your illumination correction, your distortion correction, and your chromatic aberration as well. Directly underneath of that, we have our time-lapse menu. If we enable that, we can have either a 4K or a HD time-lapse. If we go with 4K, we can set the interval for our shots, the number of shots, and the auto exposure as well as a beep taken on every image. I personally leave that disabled because if I'm going to be having my camera take a bunch of images at every 10 seconds for like 2 hours, I don't want to hear the beep every time it takes that image because that's just going to be plain obnoxious. Then directly underneath of our time lapse, we can enable our remote control. Making our way to the third page on the camera menu, we have our exposure compensation. Next up, we have our ISO settings that we can set anywhere from 100 to 25,600. Now, if we wanted to extend that, we would just click on that menu, scroll over to the maximum, and then we could go all the way up to 102,400. But personally, I wouldn't do that as the noise in the image when you go that high is absolutely insane. So I wouldn't even bother using an ISO that high. We can also set our range for the 4K movie recording as well, so we can have two different ISO settings, one for the 1080p and one for the 4K. And also directly underneath of that, we have our ISO auto settings where we can set it to a max or a minimum of a certain ISO if we know we're going to be operating in a certain exposure range. And then we also have the ability to set our auto ISO for both 4K recording as well as time-lapse recording. Directly underneath of that, we have our auto lighting optimizer. I personally leave that off as, again, I set my exposure manually and I do my lighting manually as well. We also have our highlight tone priority that we can either enable or disable. I, again, leave that disabled. We have our metering timer directly underneath of our auto slow shutter. Again, another option that I leave off. And my metering timer I set to 8 seconds. Moving our way to the last page of the camera menu, we have our white balance setting. Typically, I will set this to auto if I am in a situation where I'm going to be moving around a lot, but if I am in a situation like I am in now, where I'm going to be sitting with one camera stationary in the same spot, I'll make sure that I set my white balance for that shot so that it doesn't change in the shot. Because sometimes when people move around, it'll completely shift your color balance and your white balance. So you have to go back and redo everything in post, and that's just not fun. So this next menu is pretty cool. This is our custom white balance setting. So if you wanted to take your white balance and set it for your scene, what you would do is you would take a picture of, say, a white piece of paper or your subject holding up a color card or something like that. And then you go into the custom white balance menu and you would use that image to set your white balance. What the camera will do is it'll use all of the information from that test image to set your white balance for your scene. Directly underneath of our custom white balance settings, we have our white balance correction, so we can shift that anywhere from the blue to the orange to the green or the magenta. Directly underneath of that, we have our picture style. We have an auto, a standard, portrait, landscape, fine detail, neutral, which is the one that I personally use all the time, faithful, monochrome, and then underneath of the monochrome, you have three user-defined options. Directly underneath of our picture style, we have our Canon log setting, so we can either turn that off or on in either 8-bit or 10-bit color depths. If I was going to do that, I would do the 10-bit, so it gives me the most flexibility in post. Directly underneath of our log settings, we have our high ISO noise reduction. So if you were shooting at high ISOs, you would use this to reduce the noise in the image. I keep this at standard as I generally don't shoot at super high ISO speeds. And now directly underneath of that, we have our HDMI display, but that is grayed out currently because I do not have an HDMI connected to the camera. So next up, we have our autofocus menu. This is another pretty vast menu, so we're gonna go ahead and go through it page by page. First up, we have our autofocus method. From this menu, we can select one of seven different autofocus modes. The first is our facial tracking and IAF. This is the mode that I use the most. It's very, very reliable, and it's a very good autofocusing system. Every time I've used this autofocus system, I can't help but watch the little eye track go as it tracks my subject through my video. Next is the single point AF, and this box can be moved around the image with a couple different various methods, which we will get into later. And then your next two options are your expanded areas for your one point AF. And then after that, we have our three zone options. So we have a center zone, a vertical zone, and a horizontal zone. But like I mentioned before, I just like to use the face recognition and eye track autofocus as it is a very good and reliable system. So once we've selected our autofocus method, we can go ahead and select our frame size. And this is just the size of that autofocus box that is on your image. So we have the normal size and the small size. So after our frame size, we can either enable or disable our eye autofocus. But like I mentioned before, this is a very good and reliable system. So I would definitely suggest using that autofocus system. So next up, we have our touch and drag autofocus settings. Like I mentioned before, if you're using the single point AF, you can move that point around your image in multiple different ways. One of those is by using the touch and drag settings. And one of the great things about this setting is because there's no joystick on the back of the EOS R, we're able to move our autofocus point with our eye in the viewfinder. So we can move that with our thumb when the camera is held up to our eye, just like this. So in that menu, we can either enable or disable that. And our positioning method is either absolute or relative. I suggest using the relative setting. And then you can select the area. You can have the top, the bottom, left, right, the whole panel, the top right, bottom right, top left, bottom left. Personally, I don't really see anybody ever using that bottom left corner. I have mine set to the bottom right as I can just simply move my thumb over when I'm holding the camera and move my autofocus point around. And then our last setting is our movie servo AF. This is the continuous autofocus for video, and we can either enable or disable this. So the second page of the AF menu is our manual focus settings. Now, if you're like me and you like to use manual focus, focus peaking is one of the best tools that you can use. So on the second page, we have our peaking settings, so we can turn that off or on. We have our level. I personally like to leave it on high so that I know that everything that I'm seeing is in focus, and you can also change the color of that from red, yellow, or blue. Now on the third page, we have our continuous autofocus sensitivity settings. So we can make the sensitivity for our autofocus either faster or slower. And then underneath of that, we have this speed. So we can either speed up our autofocus or slow it down. On the fourth page of the AF menu, we have our lens electronic MF settings. We can go through and either enable or disable those. On the fifth page, we have our lens drive when AF impossible settings. This essentially is when the camera continues to search for a subject in focus in the image when it can't. So if you are having trouble finding your focus point and your camera's hunting back and forth, that's what that setting is. So in this menu, we have the option to turn that on or off. We can also limit the AF methods that that works on to any of the six options. That center point option is not available for this right now. So let's make our way over to the play menu. So we have the option to protect our images, so we can go ahead and select those, select the range, all the images in a folder, unprotect all of them, or all the images on the card, as well as unprotect all of the images on the card. What that means is if we go to delete files, the images that are protected will not get deleted. Next, we have our rotate image option, as well as the erase images. We have our print order, so this would be the order that the pictures would come in, as well as your photo book setup, your image transfer, and your raw image processing. The raw image processing is essentially taking your raw images and converting them down to a JPEG. I wouldn't do that. I would do that all in the computer. I wouldn't do any of that processing inside the camera. I'd rather have all of the flexibility in post on my computer and then make any changes from there. Under our image transfer options, we have the ability to do a direct transfer or an FTP transfer. That's either just having something directly connected to the camera, like a USB cable, and taking those images directly off the camera that way, or using the FTP server. And then we can also transfer RAW and JPEG, JPEG only or RAW only. So on the second page of the play menu, we have our cropping. Personally, I would not do any cropping inside the camera. I would do all of that in post. I'd like to have all of the image and then cropped out later. We also have our resize options. We can also rate our images. So if we know we took a certain image that we really, really liked, we can make that a like 5-star or 3-star image so that when we put everything in the computer later on, we already have an idea of which images we want to edit. We also have our slideshow, which is just a way for you to view all of your images. Next, you have your image search conditions. And lastly, you have your image jump with the scroll wheel. So what that means is with the scroll wheel on the top of the camera, if you twist that, it'll jump a certain number of images. Right now I have mine set to 10, but we can set that anywhere from 10 to 1, to a specific number, to a date, to a folder, movies, display stills only, protected images, and image rating. So on the third page, we have our playback information display. This is just the information that displays on the screen while we are playing back an image or a movie. And we can select a bunch of different options for that, and it shows you everything in that menu. Underneath of that, we have our highlight alert. We can either enable or disable this. Personally, I leave this disabled. This is just showing you when there's no detail in your image. So if you have something like a light or an outside window or something like that that is completely blown out and there's no detail in that image at all, that will alert you when you have that enabled. After that, we have the ability to either enable or disable our autofocus point display. What that means is this will show you where your autofocus point was on your image or your movie when you play it back so that you can see that your focus was where it was supposed to be. We have the options for our playback grids as well. So we have a 3x3, 6x4, 3x3 plus diagonal. I personally leave that off as I find that kind of obnoxious to watch things back with a grid. Next, we have our movie play count. So this is either your time code or your record time. I leave that on my record time. We have view from last scene, so we can either enable or disable that, which means whatever image you left off at, whenever you hit that play button again, it'll just bring you right back to that same image. And then lastly, we have our magnification options. So we have one time, which is no magnification, 2 times, 4 times, 8 times, and 10 times. Then we have actual size and same as last magnification. So next we have our wrench menu. This is another pretty vast menu, so let's go ahead and jump right into that. First, we have our folder selection. So we can select the standard folder, which is the 100EOS_R folder, but we can also create folders as well. This would be useful if we had multiple different projects on the same card, then we could already separate those out before we even put it onto the computer. So next up, we have our file numbering, and we can have that set to continuous, or we can manually reset that or auto reset that. The auto reset resets the number back to 1 when you put a new memory card in, but if you leave it on continuous, it'll continually go up all the way to, I believe it's 9,999 before it resets back down to 1 again. From here, we can change our preset to either the standard or you can have one of two user settings. I have mine set to DWV underscore, which is the initials for my freelance photography business. So I know that all of my images are going to have that prefix on them. So anytime that image is on the computer or displayed anywhere, it has that DWV underscore and then the image number. But obviously you can select either the standard or create your own. After that, we have the auto rotate, which means it'll rotate the image automatically, either on the back of the camera, in the computer, or both. And then underneath of that is where we would go to format our card. Now, I'm not going to do that as I do have images on this card that I do need, but this is where you would do that. So moving our way over to the second page, we have our eco mode and our power settings. So I usually leave eco mode off as I don't like my camera turning off randomly. And also the power saving mode, I have the display off to 30 minutes because that's the record time for this camera. So I don't want my display turning off when I'm in the middle of a recording and risk losing that recording. We also have the auto power off and the viewfinder off. I have both of those options disabled as again, I don't like things turning off when I don't want them to. Underneath of that, we can set our display brightness as well as our display color tone. I usually leave that on standard, but we have one of four options there. We have a warm tone, the standard, a cool tone one, and a cool tone two. But again, I just leave everything on standard. Next, we have our date and our time, as well as our language. So on the third page at the top, we have our video system. So we have for NTSC and for PAL. Because I'm in the United States, I use NTSC. Next, we have our touch control. So we have either standard, sensitive, or we can disable that. Next, we have our beep. And what that means is every time that we hit that shutter, it'll give you that little beep every time the autofocus is in place. Next, we have our battery info. This also gives you the shutter count for your battery. So every time you put a new battery in, it'll start that shutter count over. Next, we have our sensor cleaning. And essentially what that does is it shakes the sensor just a little bit to get any of the dust or debris off of it. You can set this to auto clean at power off like I do. You can either enable that or disable that. You can clean it now or you can clean manually. I typically don't like to touch my camera's sensor, especially on the Canon cameras that already have a pretty decent weather sealing. Back when I was using my Sony cameras, I did have a specific sensor cleaning kit, but I don't really use that for the Canon cameras. So if you're going to be cleaning your sensor, make sure you do it the right way or have a professional do it. Under that, we have our HDMI resolution, which I have set to auto, but you can have it set to automatically go to 1080p. And we also have the HDR output, which we can turn on or off. On the fourth page, we have our shooting info display. So this is the information that shows up on the screen when you are shooting or when you have the camera up to your eye. You can set those various different pages. So again, when you hit the info button on the back of the camera, you'll toggle through all of those pages. And we have that for both the LCD screen on the back as well as the viewfinder. So we can have a bunch of different options for our viewfinder as well. And again, when we hit the info button, it toggles through all of those. We have our grid display next. So we have a 3x3, a 6x4, and again, a 3x3 and diagonal. I usually leave that off unless I have something that I know that I want to frame a specific way. After that, we have our histogram display, which shows either brightness or our RGB color space. I leave that on brightness so that I can use it to set my exposure. Then we also have our display size, which we can switch between large and small. I like to leave that on large since the screen on the back is already pretty small. I like to put things pretty big on the back. And then next we have our focus distance display. I only use that when I'm in manual mode so that I know that when I'm pulling focus and I look at the back or the top of the lens and it shows me what my focus distance is, I wanna make sure that that matches up in the camera and then that way I know where to put my subject or my camera in relation to that subject. But we can set that for one of four options. We can have it in manual focus mode, only when you're focusing, always on, or disable. And then we can choose our unit for that of either meters or feet. And because I'm in the United States and I only really know what a foot looks like, I'd like to set that to feet. Next, we have our viewfinder display format, which we have one of two different options. I like to leave it on display one as that leaves me with the largest image. Next, we have our display settings. So we have our display control, either auto or manual. And if we go to manual, we can either do screen or viewfinder. Personally, I like to leave that on auto as the sensor on the back of the camera is pretty good. So whenever I pull the camera up to my eye like this, it automatically switches to the viewfinder. And then when I pull it away, it goes directly back to the screen. Next, we have our shutter button settings. So if we half press, this will either give us the meter and servo AF, meter and one shot AF, or metering only. And then the fully pressed is either the start or stop movie function or a no function. I leave that on no function since the record button is directly next to that button. I don't need two buttons directly next to each other doing the exact same thing. And then lastly, on that fourth page, we have our help text is either small or standard. I like to leave that on small. On the fifth page, we have our wireless communication settings. So we have our Wi-Fi settings, which we can enable or disable, set our password and show our connection history, as well as automatically send images to the computer and send to smartphone after a shot, as well as get our MAC address. We also have our Wi-Fi function for our phone, or if we're going to connect to a computer or cloud or something like that. Next, we have our Bluetooth function. So we can either disable that, make it for the smartphone or a remote. This is for the Bluetooth application for the phone. You can actually control the camera with the Bluetooth app on your phone. Next is the place you would go to pair that, as well as the Bluetooth address. Next, we have our send images to smartphone. My phone isn't connected to the camera right now, but this is where we would select the images to send to our phone. So if we wanted to post to social media directly after we took the image, we can go ahead and just send that directly to our phone, edit on our phone, and then upload to social media because, you know, it's Instagram. So you gotta do it instantly. Then next we have our nickname for the camera. I just leave that set to EOS R. And then we have the option to clear all of those settings and start them over. And then underneath of that, we have our GPS device settings. So we can either disable that, set it up to a GPS receiver, and then pair that. I personally don't use a GPS receiver, but this is the menu that you would go to if you were going to do that. And then the last page of the wrench menu, first at the top, we have our multifunction lock. So we can set the main dial, the rear dial, the touch control, the multifunction bar, as well as the control ring. Now the RF lenses do come with a control ring built into them, and you can program that to do pretty much everything that you could ever possibly want. And then underneath of our multifunction lock, we have the ability to set up our shooting modes, our custom shooting modes. So if we knew we wanted to have a specific setting for either 4K, we could set up a 4K mode, and then we could set up, say, a 1080 mode, and then we could set up another mode that would be, say, something like slow-mo, and you can do that all from this menu. So if you wanted to set up your custom shooting modes, you need to put your camera in the settings that you would want for that mode, then go to this menu and then select which mode you want those settings to go to. That way, when you register those settings, it will register those as the custom mode so that when you select that custom mode, all of your settings stay. Next, we have our clear all camera settings, which obviously will clear all of the settings and set it back to the factory. Then we have our copyright information, our manual software URL, as well as your certification logo display. So after our wrench menu, we have our exposure menu. The first setting on here is our exposure level increments, and we can set that from a third of a stop to a half of stop. I like to leave that on 1/3 of a stop so I can fine tune my settings as I adjust them. After our exposure level increments, we have our ISO speed setting increments. And again, I leave this on 1/3 of a stop, but we do have 1/3 of a stop and one stop. But like I mentioned, I like to leave that on 1/3 of a stop so that I can make little tiny micro adjustments. After that, we have our bracket auto cancel as well as our bracket sequence settings. We have number of bracketed shots. We can go all the way from 3 shots, 2 shots, 5 shots, and 7 shots. I'm gonna leave mine set to 3. After that, we have our safety shift. So we can set that to either off, shutter speed, or ISO speed. And what that is it will prevent an under or over exposure with your image depending on how you have it set. I like to leave that off as I like to set my exposure manually. But again, if this is something that you're not familiar with, these kinds of tools will definitely be helpful for you as you're learning to shoot photos or video. And then we have the same exposure for a new aperture, which will just adjust the other settings for your exposure, like your shutter speed or your ISO, when you change your aperture to make the exposure value the same. So on the second page of the exposure menu, we have our shutter speed range, which we can set anywhere from 30 seconds to 1/8,000th of a second. After that, we have our aperture range, which we can set anywhere from 1 to 91. And then we have our AE lock meter after focus, which we can enable for different focusing and metering modes. So on the third page of our exposure menu, we have the direction for our dials. Now this will make it so that we can set the direction for which way we want to scroll. So for instance, if we scroll to the right, which would be rotating a dial clockwise, we can make that either the positive value or the negative value, depending on how we want to set that up. And then at the bottom of that menu, we have the RF lens manual focus ring sensitivity. So we can either increase or decrease the focus sensitivity for that focus ring on the RF lens. So on the fourth page of this menu, we have the custom button settings. So this is where things get a little bit fun and we can customize the camera to however we want. So if we go ahead and click on that menu, you'll notice that there are two different menus here. We have one for the photo side of things and we have one for the video side. So if we go ahead and half press the shutter button, right now it's set to do the autofocus. If we press the movie button, that's going to start a movie recording, and so on and so forth down the line. You can set these to do pretty much anything you want as long as the option is available. And again, you can set these buttons to do different things for both photo and video mode. So after we set up our custom buttons, we can go ahead and set up our custom dials. Now these dials are going to be the same for both photo and video mode. So whatever mode you're in, it's going to do the same thing. So if we go in, the front dial can be your exposure, your aperture, or it can have no function. And same thing with the back dial or the dial that is around the mode button, as well as the control ring. Now keep in mind, the control ring is only available on RF lenses. You can't use a control ring on an EF lens because obviously it doesn't have a control ring. Unless, of course, you have the control ring adapter. Next, we can set up the infamous touch bar. From here, we have the option to set it for both photo and video mode for different settings. Personally, I don't use this bar. I don't really like it. I'm not a huge fan of it, but you can set it to do things like ISO speed, you can do movie recording, autofocus, white balance, all kinds of different stuff. But again, I personally don't use it, and I know a lot of people don't, but it does have the ability to do a bunch of different functions. So if at the end of the day, you want to go ahead and get rid of all of those custom settings, you can just go to the bottom here and click the clear customize settings option, and that will clear all of your customized settings and bring you back to the factory. So on the fifth page, we have our cropping information, and what this does is it adds lines on your image to show you where the image is going to be cropped. So if you know you're going to be shooting at a specific crop ratio, you can just shoot directly into that ratio and not really have to worry about it, making sure that your subject and everything that needs to be in your scene is in your scene. Personally, I leave the crop set to off, as I can always do cropping later on in post, whether that's for video or for photo. I don't really understand why anybody would want to do that directly in camera, as pretty much every photo editing software, even on your phone, allows you to crop. Next, we have the default erase options, as well as the release shutter without lens, which means your shutter would fire when you don't have a lens on there. I wouldn't do that, as it protects your sensor to not have that shutter release when there's no lens on there. But again, you can change that if you want to. Then after that, we have the retract lens with power off. What that means is if you had a power zoom lens or a lens that extended a little bit when it focused in, when you turn the camera off, it'll bring it all the way back to its most retracted position. And next, we have the ability to add IPTC information, which is just a way for the computer to communicate with the camera once the computer is connected to that camera. And then on the last page, we have the option to completely clear any of the custom functions that we set up. So if you wanted to reset everything back to its factory settings, you would just click that and reset everything back to the beginning. So now the star menu is our custom menu settings. So if we wanted to have a specific menu option in a specific spot, we could go ahead and do that here. And we would do that by going to the Add a My Menu tab, and then it'll bring up the option to configure that, as well as select items to register, sort your registered items, delete your selected items, delete all your items, delete tab, or rename tab. So now we're going to go ahead and switch the camera into the photo mode, and then we're going to go over the camera menu once more with the photo mode enabled, as this does bring up some different options in that menu. So on the first menu, we have the ability to select our image quality. Personally, I like to leave that at RAW and JPEG, the reason being that if I have a client that wants to see images right after I've taken them, or even the day of me taking them, I can just send them over the JPEGs that are unedited, and they're significantly smaller than trying to send the RAW files over. But you can have either RAW and JPEG, and you can select the different sizes for each one of those. So for your JPEGs, you have two large options, a medium option, and as well as three smaller options. And then for your raw settings, you have your no raw, you have your regular raw, and then you have your Canon raw. Canon raw is a slightly compressed raw file. It keeps your file sizes down, but gives you the flexibility of having raw in post. Next, we have dual pixel raw. And what dual pixel raw is, it will use two pixels to create the same image. So essentially what it's doing is it's taking two images at the same time and combining them together. And what that does is it lets you pull your focus ever so slightly in post. Again, this is not something that I typically use, as it does make the file sizes much larger because you are using two files to make these images. But if you wanted to have the ability to change your focus in post ever so slightly, then you can shoot in the dual pixel raw. So for the crop and aspect ratio, we have pretty much the same aspect ratios that we did for video. Again, I don't crop in camera, but you do have the ability to do that. And we have the full frame, a 1.6 times crop, a 1-to-1 ratio, a 4-to-3 ratio, and a 16-by-9 ratio. We also have image review, and we can have the image review up for 2 seconds, 4 seconds, 8 seconds. We can have it hold until we want to take another picture or off. And I set it to off because it's really, really annoying when I'm taking pictures to have the last picture that I took pop up for 2 seconds so that it pretty much blacks my screen out and I can't see what my camera is seeing. I don't like that at all. I leave that off. That's a setting that I will always leave off. I don't like image review. If I want to look at my images, I'll just hit that playback button and look at them there. Underneath of that, we have the release shutter without card, which means the shutter will fire if you don't have a card in a camera. I leave that off because there's really no reason to have that on. Moving over to that second menu, we have again those lens aberration corrections. We went over that earlier, but we now have the external speed light control, which is the control for an external flash. I don't really use external flash, so I don't really know what all these settings are, but this is where they are in the menu. And then if we scroll over to the third page, we have our exposure compensation. Again, like I mentioned in video, I don't like to use the exposure compensation as I like to set my exposure manually, but if you wanted to set that, that is where that would be, as well as your ISO speed settings, which we mentioned earlier, your light optimizer, your highlight tone priority, your metering, and your exposure simulation. The exposure simulation is nice because when you are viewing things in your EVF, it'll give you an image based on the settings that you have, so you can kind of see what your camera is going to see before you take the picture, which is really, really nice to have in certain situations. And on this fourth menu, we have our white balance settings, which are exactly the same as we talked about earlier. But something I do want to mention is if you shoot a photo in monochrome, that photo in JPEG will not have any of the color data. But if you shoot a monochrome photo in RAW, it'll retain that color information so that you can make those changes in post. But again, if you're shooting in monochrome and JPEG, you're not going to have any of that color information. Just something for you to note. And then on the fifth page, we have our long exposure noise reduction, which again, we talked about earlier, as well as the high ISO speed noise reduction, the dust delete data, and the touch shutter. All of these we touched earlier with the video side, and these are the exact same settings. And then on the last page of this camera menu, we have our bulb timer, our anti-flicker shoot, our silent shutter. This camera does have the ability to shoot with a silent shutter since it is a mirrorless camera. We also have our silent live view shooting, as well as our high-speed display. Now, for the most part, our autofocus settings are all going to be the same as video, but there is one difference that I want to make note of. If you go under the fourth page of the AF manual, you'll notice that there is an AF beam assist firing. What that means is this will fire the little LED that is on the front, and if you're in a dark situation and that beam fires off, it's just going to draw attention to you. I leave that set to off or disabled, as I don't like using that. I really don't enjoy having attention drawn to me when I'm trying to shoot, especially in a dark situation, but this is where you would set that to turn on or off. All right, guys, so that's going to do it for our full Canon EOS R tutorial. If you have any questions or comments, go ahead and leave them down in the comment section down below. And while you're down there, make sure you hit that like and subscribe button, as it really does help us out here on the channel. And if you guys have any other pieces of gear or cameras that you want to see tutorials for, please let us know and we'll make sure we get those out for you. Thanks for watching today's episode, and I'll see you all in the next one.